is a discrete homomorphic function or discrete harmonic vector field because it's a gradient of harmonic function. But we'll later see that it has many of the same properties. Okay, so what I want to do in the remaining 20-something minutes, I want to just say a few basic things about discrete harmonic functions without doing discrete homomorphic functions and about their relation to probability. Now, just a question to organize. So, like random walk connection, or was it mentioned? No? Or uniform spanning tree connection? Yeah, okay. Okay, maybe I'll speak about a bit about the random walks. So let's. Okay. So we deal with the So the discrete harmonic part. So now we pass into the rigorous term. So discrete harmonic functions. So we have a finite graph. So what one can think, and we have a function h from vertices of G into real numbers. Now, what we can think about as graphs, so in most of our cases, we would have graphs which are parts of the lattice. So for example, well, something like that. So we will mostly deal with the graphs of this sort, that we take a finite chunk of the square lattice. So the definition of harmonic function, which was already written there, is that h is the Laplacian of h at u is the sum for all v which are connected, which are neighbors of u, of h of v minus h of v. So h, we say, to be harmonic if the Laplacian of h is equal to v. Now, why we should call this a Laplacian? Well, there are several reasons. So first, so how does the usual Laplacian arise? It arises in the heat equation. So if you have a function h, which is the distribution of heat somewhere, and you want to sort of know what will happen next minute, you calculate Laplacian at a point, and this will be how heat will change at this point. So here it would be the same. If you have distribution of heat at this sides, and each side it interacts with the nearby sides, then you should look at the sum of gradients over these interactions, and this will tell you how it will change. Moreover, if we take, so mostly we'll be taking, working with the discretizations like this, so suppose that this lives on a mesh epsilon lattice, mesh epsilon lattice, so this is discrete domain, let's say omega epsilon inside mesh epsilon lattice. So we'll put mesh right away because we'll be passing to scaling limits later, so it will be convenient to do this. So assume that h small is the usual, an exercise. Suppose h small is a harmonic function, is the usual harmonic function in the full complex plane or in some domain omega which is slightly bigger than this omega epsilon. Then what can we say about the discrete Laplacian of this h small? Then the discrete Laplacian, yeah, maybe usually it won't make any difference, but usually I will be either dealing with the discrete object with the continuous, but let me just for now put epsilon whenever the object is discrete. So what will be, we can calculate, what we can say about delta A epsilon of H. So the exercise is that this is something of the order of O capital epsilon to the power 4, I think. So if we start with the usual harmonic function restricted to mesh epsilon lattice and we try to calculate discrete Laplacian, we get something which is very, very small. So just calculate what will happen if you plug in these four points, which are epsilon L, just do the Taylor expansion. And so this is an exercise.
Okay. This depends on the lattice.
You see, I did plot the square later, so we'll come to this later. This is actually we'll come later to this point. What is a good discretization of complex analysis? Well, the answer is that I don't know. And there is a good reason why there are no textbooks about discrete complex analysis, and the reason is that if you discretize harmonic analytic functions, then you can pretty much do first quarter of a complex analysis textbook without sweating much. So you prove that they have maximum principle, that the real part of analytic function is harmonic, and so on and so on. But you cannot multiply holomorphic functions. Their product is no longer holomorphic on the discrete, so we will see this tomorrow. And there are many other properties which are even worse on lattice. So if, for example, if I change lattice on many graphs, it will be just epsilon cubed. So here it's epsilon to the power 4 because of symmetries. So this 4 shows that square lattice in a sense is better than just arbitrary graph. So this of course depends on the graph. But this is sort of the best case. Okay. And now,
just say a few things.
So the main property there is a solution to the Dirichlet problem. So suppose that we have the same picture as before. So domain. And let me add some boundary vertices. So I'll just add the first vertices which are sticking outside omega. So here, for some technical reasons, for us will be sometimes better to distinguish the these two points. Now it's not really important, but sometimes later it will be important. So the Dirichlet problem asks to find H, which is H, such that Laplacian of H is zero inside omega, and H is given to something, to some prescribed function on the boundary of omega. So by boundary of omega, I mean these points. So we prescribe, given phi on boundary of omega, find H. And the main theorem is that there is a unique H like that. So it's pretty much like the Dirichlet problem in the continuous, that you have function on the boundary of domain and you ask to find the harmonic function inside of this boundary data. Yeah, by the way, again, I want to repeat that, so I've drawn this picture, but a priori we now work just on arbitrary graph, not necessarily a piece of a square lattice, not necessarily embedded in the plane, just arbitrary graph. It would just work as well for any graph of the, so I draw anything, and just I say which vertices are boundary vertices, so I say prescribe that this vertex is boundary, this is boundary, this is boundary, these two are boundary, and then what this theorem means is that I can find function H which has prescribed values in these boundary vertices, and everywhere else it is harmonic. At each other point it has mean value property, that it's the mean of its neighbors. Okay. So do we prove it or do we leave it as an exercise? Let's have, it's actually one, we have three organizers so we can have democratic procedures. So we'll have two-tier democracy. We elected the organizers. Well, did we? Well, never mind. And then now they will vote. Should I prove it or should I leave it as an exercise? Who thinks I should prove it? Vladas, exercise. Okay, so the exercise is to prove that there is a unique age like that, and there are two things that for the uniqueness, so for the existence. Well, maybe I will just do the hint. Minimize the energy. Minimize energy of H, which is the sum over all U and V neighbors, H of U minus H of V squared. So just like for the usual one, so if you minimize it, then it will give a solution of that. And uniqueness one can do from the maximal principle. So it's existence and uniqueness use the maximum principle. Show that H can have no maximum or minimum inside. So there are two hints. Now there is some sort of exercise session where this can be worked out, yeah? Or it's too easy. Yeah, okay. Now there are a few interpretations of H, so there are, and so one is with these flows, which we already mentioned. Another one is with the rubber bands that you make this picture out of rubber bands. So you put a rubber band which is exactly 10 centimeters long for every edge, and then for each point you position it this distance of the blackboard, which is prescribed by phi. So for example, if phi is here 100, I take it at the distance 1/2. If phi here is 0, I take it on the blackboard. If phi here is 2, I take it distance 2. And then I have this network of rubber bands, and it will sort of be fixed according to the Hooke law in some. So we assume that Hooke law approximates very well what is going on, and then it will be fixed, and we'll get some distribution of heights. It will be exactly what is here, because the energy will be given by this formula. So it's the rubber bands. And the third is the random walk exit probabilities. So let's put H of Z to be the expectation that the random walk. So random walk from the point Z. Eventually, it will hit the boundary of the domain, and it will exit through one of these points. So let me just denote the tau to be the hitting time. And then, so we start at Z, we hit the boundary at time tau, there is our position which is on the boundary, so we can evaluate function phi. So the expectation of phi when we hit the boundary is the desired function. And that's another exercise. So check that such so defined H is harmonic and has needed boundary values. It's phi of the boundary. Okay. And now I will formulate a theorem which will, well, we will probably prove something similar. So so usually it's attributed to current Friedrichs and Hans Levy. So what they did, they proved this theorem, but in much better generality for a wider class of operators than Laplace. And it's not clear who first proved it for Laplace. And so certainly Pelli and Vinian did it before with Friedrichs and Levy, but there are about a dozen papers at the same, more or less, 10-year period where people prove it. So what they proved is that, so what is the setup? We take domain omega. So they for simplicity took it with the, well, not necessarily smooth, but well, we take domain omega, so they took it with a smooth boundary. We take phi defined in neighborhood, so phi smooth in neighborhood of domain omega. So we define boundary data in some neighborhood of omega because we are going to discretize and these points are not exactly on the boundary of omega. Then we discretize. So we put omega epsilon to be intersection of epsilon z squared with omega. And then there is this function h epsilon, which is equal to phi on boundary of omega epsilon, and which is harmonic inside. And then you can define function h, which is equal to phi on the boundary of omega, and which is exactly harmonic inside. And then h epsilon converges to h small uniformly inside omega. I think this is the sort of their paper is also the first where sort of clearly discussed that you can apply this to random walk and prone in motion because they mention this and other connections to the random walk, to the Green's function of random walk being solution of the Dirichlet problem, and then they say that since we prove this theorem, it also means that we can deduce something about convergence of random walk to Einstein's Brownian motion. So it was, I think, their paper is slightly before Wiener's paper. So it was before Wiener process was constructed. So it was sort of, it wasn't known as a Brownian motion at the time as a measure on trajectories, but it was known over like things like probabilities of distributions were known. Okay. Now, I don't think I want to prove it. So there are several ways to prove it. One way to prove it is just to use this. So if you are in the probability, you can use this identity to prove it. So if you know that random walk converges to Brownian motion, then you know that all the functionals of random walk converge to functionals of Brownian motion. And for Brownian motion, if you plug in here Brownian motion, you get h small. So it's, maybe here it's a good remark, is that h small of z is equal to the same phi Brownian motion stopped at tau, stopped at z. And this is a theorem of Kokutani. So the proof, one proof which is possible is to use that random walk converges to Brownian motion.
Can you write larger?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I was just about to ask whether I should write larger, but then I figured out that in the remaining 10 minutes I can. I don't know. That's probably. Should I write like that? Is it okay if I write like that? Yeah, I'm sorry if I was writing too small. So so use that random walk convergence to Brownian motion. Well, that's a bit perverse actually in this proof. That's a bit of an overkill. So this is probably it's the easiest for people who know already how to do random walk to Brownian motion convergence. Now if the way they did, they use the energy estimates, because essentially. So we know that the solution H minimizes the energy. So this energy is essentially the Sobolev norm of H. So we know the discrete Sobolev norm, so use energy. So what do we know? We know that our function H minimizes I of H. What does it mean that function minimizes I of h? It means that its energy is more than energy of any other function. So if I plug in something which has this boundary awareness, but it's smooth, I get bigger energy. So let's just continue phi inside any way you wish. So you just continue phi smooth neighborhood, so we can continue inside. So in particular, I of h is more than I of phi, which is some given number, 100, whatever. So it means that it has some small Sobolev norm. So I of h, well, formally, what is it? It's sum of gradient squared. So it's sum of gradient h squared. So we have an estimate of the Sobolev norm. So we have a bunch of functions with bounded Sobolev norm. So they are precompact in any reasonable topology. So for example, functions with bounded integral, square integral of derivative among continuous functions will form a precompact family. So you can choose a converging subsequence. And moreover, since you know this estimate, you can already say something that it will converge even better than a continuous topology. And then what you have to check, you have a converging sequence of functions which satisfy which are discretely harmonic, you have to show that the limit is harmonic. And I don't think we do it here. We better do it tomorrow with the discrete analytic functions. So this is enough to find converging subsequence. So there is h epsilon j which converges to some inside omega, which converges to some function, or let's say h tilde. So the question is whether h tilde is equal to h, whether let h tilde is harmonic and h tilde is equal to phi on boundary of omega. So these are two things one has to settle, and for the first one, it's just you have to come up with a criteria to check harmonicity, which is not local. So we are checking that Laplacian at point is zero. It's easier to check some criteria which is spread over the area, for example. So for example, harmonic functions, they have mean value property. A point value is mean is equal to mean on the circle. If we are able to check the same for the discrete approximately, then we are done. So they sort of proceed that way, but actually they obtain here convergence of all the derivatives by using some integral representations. So here they check some integral representations. And then the second, it requires some further work because we have these Sobolev estimates inside the domain. So a priori they don't give estimates on the boundary. You need to have nice boundary so that they give, this is the keywords, if you heard them, they are concurrent Sobolev inequalities. So If you have function with bounded Sobolev norm at the end of the cusp, it still might blow up. So that's why they ask for the smoothness of the boundary, and then they do some work here. But I think we will use it as a tool, but I don't think we will prove it, but we will prove some similar theorem for amorphic functions. And I think I'll stop here. So what we'll do tomorrow, we'll do convergence, we'll do some properties of discrete analytic functions, we'll see how they appear in uniform spanning tree, and we'll do convergence of some zeros for uniform spanning tree. Questions? That's it.
So now, if you are a very clever guy, you should. Nobody's clever. So, something is wrong from the beginning. Well, something is very wrong. Something does not turn in the counterclockwise sense. What? I'm considering a spanning tree on the complete graph, Kn. How many vertices does this graph have? It's for the camera. How many vertices the graph K sub n? N.
Yes.
How many vertices does this graph have? Kn. How many vertices? The graph Kn.
No, you're diabetic.
Well, n. So you've got n vertices. And since the beginning of this tutorial, I've been telling you that, well, the order of the branch is order square root of n. So this is square root of n, this is square root of n, square root of n, square root of n, square root of n. Well, square root of n is very small compared to n. Where are the other points? Well, they vanished in the scaling limit. They vanished, but not totally, because you could say that you keep doing this construction with all the fragments here. So you've got something like this. And it's not so easy, but it can be shown that this tree, I mean the diameter of this tree, does not explode, does not blow up. So you remain finite. So you have something random, of course, but something very arborescent like this. Okay? But this, if I tell you that this is the scaling limit, so this should be the CRT. Something is wrong. Why? Because the CRT must be a compact set. Well, this is not closed. Well, if you know the CRT, you should be aware of the fact that the CRT, the other dimension of the CRT is 2, like the Brownian motion. But this is just a union of segments. A countable union of segments. So the other dimension of this thing is 1. So something is lost. So you should, if you want to define the CRT in this way, you should take this object that we built from the stick breaking, which is called the stick breaking due to Aldous. You should take this space and take the closure of this space, because many, many points have been lost. You've got n points. They are in the leaves. They are here. Well, I can make a zoom. Something like this. This is a countable graphing of branches. And you can define the point at the limit here, which is not on a branch. So this point is not in the union of segments. So you have to take the closure to make these points appear. And well, at least heuristically, it's obvious, because we have been considering things at the order square root of n, and we had n points. So we've lost some points, so we have to add them at the limit. And a way of adding them is to take the closure of this thing. So I recap. So the CRT. CRT was the scaling limit of uniform trees. Okay, but I told you in the beginning of this tutorial that this scaling limit is this CRT can also be obtained as a scaling limit of all other Galton-Watson process. Well, provided they have a finite variance. And we considered the Poisson-Galton-Watson process. Why? Because the Poisson-Galton-Watson process, if you condition it on having n vertices, you label them uniformly at random, then you have a KLie tree, uniformly distributed. And the KLie tree can be seen as a uniform spanning tree on the graph KN. And we had a way of constructing a spanning tree of the graph KN by this Abduce-Broder algorithm, which, well, you have a simple random walk and they up, you hit your path, you bring another branch, you hit your path, you bring another branch, etc. So we add, well, not we, but Abduce had in mind that this, the scaling limit of this process of growing the spanning tree should converge to a process, and you could define the CRT out of that. This is the case because we completely understood the length of the branches, which at the scaling limit is given by the length of the inter points of Poisson point process of intensity t times the Lebesgue measure. And conditionally on this length, then the grafting point was uniformly on the path, uniformly chosen on the path. But to be proper and to define the CRT, then you have to take the closure of this thing to have the compact metric space that you are looking for. 10 seconds, last remark. This one is not obvious at all. So remember that the CRT, well, maybe 20 seconds, remember that the CRT was given, well, was constructed by Jean-François Le Gall as the tree coded by an excursion, a Brownian excursion. Okay? So if you want somehow to comment dire, rebondir? To bounce on the question of Balazs, if you want to understand the finite marginals of the CRT, you want to understand what does it give if you take, say, well, two points uniformly chosen on the CRT. So you can define that as, okay, you take U1 and U2, two uniform variables of over 0,1, and you you take the projection of U1 and the projection of U2, and you want to understand what is the distance between these two points. So I'll let you think about that, but the subtree span by these two points is just this subtree that I've drawn in blue in this picture. Okay? Well, it's obvious. Okay, and if you want to understand what is the geometry of this subtree, you want to understand what is the length of this branch, of this one, and of this one. And not obvious, but true, this, well, two constants, this blue thing is exactly given by this process at step two. That is, you have a first branch, well, which was, say, this one, and you graph another branch to this one with the steep break. This was the first one and the second one. Well, I tell you, and this is true, that these two things, they have the same distribution. In other words, the point where you finish your first branch in the spanning tree, this end is a uniform point on the CRT. Well, now let's go to sleep. Thank you. Any questions? You can ask the cameraman for the first paradox.